When was the last time you used an ATM? Today? Cool. Yesterday? Within this week? At least few times this month? That's amazing. And based on what I saw during the last session, you all are really good at problem solving. Agree? Yeah. So I'm going to give you a challenge. Take 5 minutes. Oh, it says 5 minutes. Take a piece of paper and design the next generation ATM. Maybe you can draw the ATM, or you want to list down the features you are going to put in. I highly recommend you to give it a try. So, how does your ATM looks like? You might have include new use cases, right? New features. And maybe new, you might have connected maybe another banking operation with the ATM. Anyone who completely got rid of the ATM? Yeah. Some might even do that. So that's what we are really good at. Throughout our education, since we were small, we have been trained to solve problems. You throw me a problem, I'll give you a solution. Isn't that what happened during the last activity as well? That's we have been trained, and we have been encouraged to be analytical thinkers. At the same time, whenever we have a problem, what we do is, we start with maybe few options, and you start filtering them out, and zoom to that one solution, and you start thinking about that solution. Okay, this is working, okay? Maybe your startup idea, or the idea you are using for this competition is also something like that. You have encountered the problem. As soon as you encountered, you start thinking about, okay, how can we solve this problem? Maybe you got together, use your analytical thinking, and you zoom to a stable solution, right? So that's how humans are in nature, not only in Sri Lanka, anywhere in the world. After getting those years of education, that's where we end up. So this is known as convergent thinking. As humans, when we were thrown at a lot of options, we are really good at converging into one solution using our analytical thinking. Today we are going to practice something different. We are also good at this, but what we do is, whenever we generate options, we filter them. So, like you have seen earlier, during design thinking, we exchange between these two mindsets. Sometimes you diverge, you intentionally generate options, and sometimes you use those options to generate, to zoom into one solution. I'll come to that later. So today, we are going to practice design thinking by hands-on application. So, whenever we try to get into business, or when we try to have a startup idea, this is what we start with. We think of solutions that are technically feasible, at the same time, that has a business viability. Like you learned earlier, we include another circle that's called human desirability. Okay, this could be a good solution that makes business sense, but at the same time, it is technically feasible, but is it something that appeal into the humankind, or whether it's integrate to humankind without any pain points? So when we find these three, and when we balance these three, we call human-centered design, as you learned earlier. So theoretical definition, there are many different definitions for design thinking. No need to write it down. The summary is, it's a human-centered approach to problem solving using designer's toolkit. So designers have been trained to solve problems throughout the history. That's their job. It's a repeatable process. So what we are doing is, we take few tools from designer's toolkit and spread out across the world so that anyone can apply them to solve any problem. It doesn't have to be a big problem like your startup idea. It can be a tiny problem. Anything small, big, you can apply design. And on the other hand, it's a creative problem solving mechanism. So let's get back to our ATM challenge. So today you are going to unlock that potential to generate options. Because what we have been trained is to do is, whenever you come up with the idea, what happens? Let's say you are working in a group and someone comes up with the idea. What others do? We criticize, we argue, and we start filtering out. So whenever you see an idea, it's very hard not to criticize. Even when you meet a user, if you have idea, they will start, okay, this is bad, this is good. So today, we are going to, so first learning today, we are going to practice the art of generating options without filtering them. So that we will end up in a lot of options. And at some point, we can start filtering them out. So this is a group activity. In fact, partners activity. So you need to find someone you don't normally associate with, someone new, and pair up. Can we do it quickly? So earlier, when you were trying to solve this designer ATM challenge, you were basically designed for yourself, right? In a way, you might have to design for someone else, but in most cases, what we do is we design for ourselves. So today we are going to practice design for someone else. So we are going to still going to design the next generation ATM, but this time you are going to design for your partner. So both of you will be designing completely two different ATMs based on your partner's need. I'll come back to this later. So the technique we are going to use, it's very simple technique, interview. Right? So what do we normally do when we interview people? Yeah, we ask questions to? Yes, get feedback. At the same time, we collect information. Today, we are going to do a little bit different. Don't try to collect information. Instead of, try to understand the person. Why this person uses an ATM? What's the actual need in this modern world? Why you are still using an ATM? What's the story behind it? Right? So by the way, you can name one person, or maybe the person on the left as the partner one and the other person as partner two. So before that, another important one. And I'll give you 30 seconds to do something. You saw what it is. So 30 seconds, draw a sunset. Okay, I have been doing this for a while, so I know what exactly in your painting. So it's a beach. So sun is sinking to the ocean. And it's a typical sun with a circle with lines. And if you had enough time, you might have drawn one or two palm trees, a kite, maybe a few birds, and the sun, you can see the sun reflected on the water, right? So, the second part. Now, I'll give you something different to draw. Now be very specific. Don't draw a sunset. Take a minute and, or not minute, few seconds and try to remind last time you saw a sunset. And now draw that. Right, good. I think it's 30 seconds. So, now if I try to guess what's in your sunset, unless I like spend the last sunset with you, I wouldn't be able to, right? So, what's the difference? In first instance, I ask you to draw a sunset, a typical sunset. those hypothetical, wishful thinking sunset. That's what happened to us when we try to interview someone or when we try to find the background behind the problem. We have, as humans, we have a lot of, we are good at generalization. So we have generalized needs and even users or the people into stereotypes. So whenever I say sunset, you have a mental image, you put that down on the paper. But actually, if you speak to people, unless they live close to the beach, that type of a beach, they wouldn't see a sunset like that. That's what typically happens when you interview someone also. You ask typical questions. And the people also answer with typical answers. How do you use ATM? Whenever I need money, I go to the ATM, put the card, enter the PIN, get the money and go. That's the wishful thinking, the typical world as we like to perceive. But actual, if you think about last time you went to ATM, you might have had a bigger story, just like the last sunset you drove. So, the bottom line, when you are trying to study something or when you want to build empathy towards your problem, the context matters. Don't try to design solutions for general world. Generalization can happen later, but start with some real actual experience. So the activity we are going to do, now the partner one is going to interview the partner two. Right? So partner one asks questions, partner two answers. Partner one, try to be very specific. Try to use that context. Don't let your user, the person you are interviewing, to generalize answers. If they say answer with normally, that sounds like they are generalizing. Be specific. Put them to ask, okay, what really happened? So ask them to describe last time what happened when they visited an ATM. Right? Shall we do that? 3 minutes. Right? Cool. So now, change. Now it's your turn to ask questions if you have been answering. So remember, don't try to collect information. You are not after collecting information. You are listening to their story. What happened during that visit? What makes them to go to that ATM? Ask questions around that. You don't need information. We are not going to do anything with this information. You are just listening to a story. You are getting to know someone. So what type of question did you ask? Were you collecting information still? Or were you still pitching an idea? You have an idea, okay, this person needs this type of solution and I'll try to pitch that solution. So if you ask questions like, what kind of transaction you did with the ATM? How many of you ask a question like, what was the transaction? None. Okay. Did you ask how much are you willing to pay extra? So that sounds like you have a solution and you are trying to set the boundary. That's fine. So that's why we are going to try something different this time. So this time we are going to dig deeper, meaning we are going to ask a lot of questions that start with why. While remembering the information you already collected during the last interview, this time ask questions, why question around that experience. Why did you go to the ATM? Why did you do that? Keep asking why questions. Same as 5-why method says, if you ask why questions 5 times, you get to the root cause, the actual problem. So let's practice that. So this time, you are trying to understand why this person has done certain actions. Earlier, you were scratching on the surface, collecting certain level of information about what they have done during their last specific visit. Right? And again, during this interview, try to get rid of your solution mindset. We are trying to understand what exactly going through with this particular person. What happened to him? What happened to her? What kind of experience that person went through? Were they happy or sad? Were they feeling distressful or were they happy to go to the ATM? So, shall we try asking why questions this time? So, part number one. Sorry, I forget what sound is like. So, this time what we are trying to find out is asking why questions. If ATM is the solution, if next generation ATM is the solution, what is the actual problem we are trying to solve? The ATM is actually a solution. If you can understand, if you can surface why this person needs a new kind of ATM, you will discover a problem. Maybe the solution for that problem might not be an ATM. So that's why we are asking why questions. So, partner one, partner two, we have 4 minutes, or maybe 3 minutes since we started a little bit late. So, this time ask a lot of why questions around their story. You know what to do now, right? Exchange, swipe, and now the partner two get to do what partner one did. Ask 5 questions around their story. So can I have your attention? What did you learn? What is the thing you discovered you didn't know when you started this exercise about your, in most cases, your friend? Even though I asked to find someone you don't know. What did you discover? Maybe they have a landlord who demand money at 1 AM in the morning. Or they are scared of cash, or they don't want to carry their wallet, or they are really bad at money management, they don't trust in credit cards. So now you have discovered completely different picture about this particular person where you try to design an ATM. So next thing I want you to do is, now individually, without talking to anyone, reflect on the interview you just had, the experience you had, and your partner's lifestyle, their story, the real problem you might have discovered, and we are going to write down a few things, so better to have a piece of paper. So earlier, we had a person who was asking for an ATM. Now you might have discovered you are sitting next to a person who goes to ATM to get money, physical money, because they need to pay to the canteen in cash. So that's a very important point. Earlier we were working with a solution, now we have a problem. So typically solutions are described using nouns. So earlier we were trying to design an ATM. Maybe in previous session you were trying to design a straw. So that's a solution. You have limit yourself to design a particular solution. But when you apply design thinking, you need to go one step back and try to understand if the ATM is the problem. Sorry, if the ATM is a solution, what is the problem we have to solve? So if you had led to something like this, now we are in a completely different domain. Instead of designing an ATM for this particular person, now you have a bigger stage where you can design various different solutions so that you can enable that person. Maybe that's the only requirement they have for cash. That maybe that's the only case where they have to go to ATM. In other cases, they can use their card. So now you don't have to design ATM. Leave them aside. Make sure that person or the canteen get the payment in a different way. So I'm sure you all of you have heard this famous quote by Henry Ford. If I had asked for what people want, they would have said faster horses. So first lesson, if you didn't learn anything up to now from my session, when you think about your startup, don't try to build faster horses. Take a moment, take a few weeks off and try to figure out what's the actual problem that I was earlier trying to solve. Right? So that's the first lesson from design thinking. Figuring out the right problem by connecting to another human being. That's what you have learned. You are not going ahead with your preconceived ideas, designing to yourself. The second learning, we don't design based on the typical, hypothetical scenarios, those generalized audience. You have to design for a specific human being. And when you start designing, you can amplify to the rest of the world. Start with a Especially start with, if you can start with an extreme user who have a weird habit. There are enough examples on how they have started designing for extreme users, and then that led to remarkable discoveries. So what are the lessons? Maybe I have a slide on that. Don't reinvent solutions. Try to solve a problem using design thinking, or try to doing a startup or a business. Try to solve a problem. Don't try to reinvent an already existing solution. So we are not working with solutions. We are working with needs. Do we have agreement? Cool. So I was talking about writing down. So we are going to write down two things. First, we are going to write down needs. What are the needs of this particular individual? My partner's needs related to this ATM story. What are the actual needs? Why do they need cash? Or what insecurities they have? Write them down. The second one, any insights you have discovered. Insights are things like, things that gives you like sparks. Okay, when you are listening to that person, it might have given you some spark. Ah, maybe I can do this. Ah, this is interesting. Write down those kind of things. So, 3 minutes quickly on a piece of paper. Write down few needs and maybe interesting insights that connect to that particular need. That person has to pay money to the canteen. Has to pay money to the canteen is kind of a need. Maybe the insight would be, canteen is an old canteen. They only accept cash. And they are very picky about change. So even though you have, when you withdraw from ATM, you get like 5,000 and 1,000 and a blah, blah, blah. Every week you have to go back to the, so that might be the only cash transaction that person do. Go back to the ATM to get even change. So over a time, that person has developed a habit of going for a small amount so that person gets change. So that's the insight. You go after the need and try to figure out the insight behind that. Right? Shall you do that quickly? 3 minutes? One or two needs and insights will be good enough. What did you hear from your partner? Write them down. Needs and insights. And to summarize the first part of the workshop, you need to empathize the problem you are trying to solve, empathize about the problem you are trying to solve by talking to actual human being in a specific context before what we are really good at, jumping into solution, generating ideas, right? Remember, talk to actual human being, pick a stream user if it is possible, someone who's be different from the rest of the people because they are very interesting, and talk to them on a very specific context, not on a sunset, on a last sunset or a specific sunset you prefer. And then you listen to their stories, not to collect information, as a curious person. As we say, as with a beginner's mindset. You are not judging them, you are listening to them just to get insights and understand their needs. Right? What we are going to do next is, now we are going to define the problem we are going to solve. Now you have a lot of insights, you have a deep understanding about your users, and now you want to define, okay, what's the problem I'm going to focus on? There are a lot of techniques, as you learned earlier. We are going to use the technique called point of view. So now we are going to write down the problem from the point of view of the your user, where you have used for your empathy. So this is the format. We are going to write down the user, the need they have. You can pick one out of your list, and the insight that's connected to that. So when you write down, this could be an example, just to give you inspired. User, a university student, need, stay away from alcohol. Insight, alcohol can damage the developing brain by killing off brain cells, and alcohol can hurt your liver, which you need to clean your blood. So this technique is called what? Point of view. Does this sounds like a point of view from a university student? Nah, right? So when you write this one, you have to write it down from university student's perspective, your partner's perspective, not from your perspective or again as generalized concept. Because if you start with this, the end product will be, the ideas generated around this particular problem will be like posters saying that alcohol is bad, TV ads. That's not going to solve anything. It's not from the point of view of that particular person you are trying to help. So the first problem in this one, university student, that's way too general. Agree? Can we assume all university students are the same? That's a big group with vast majority of people come from different backgrounds with different needs. So in that case, it's good to be a little bit more specific. Second one, you need to write down the need from that person's perspective. Third one, insights should be something, not theoretical like this, something connect to that person from that person's perspective. So if I have to write this one again, this would be maybe a better way to write the point of view statement. User, first year male students who stays in a university hostel. Maybe during first 2-3 weeks. And for some reason, that particular person has the need to feel included. Maybe while staying away from alcohol, maybe a religious reason or maybe a strong belief, but still that person needs to feel included in the rest of the students in the hostel. Agree? Inside, it's not about that health. It's more related to, in universities, social groups are more important than physical long-term health. So if you start with a problem like this, it actually, you can visualize that person, that problem, and maybe if you solve this, you might end up in somewhere. Agree? So shall we write down point of view statements? One statement based on your needs and insights. So this is the, I'll leave the example on the screen. You have 3 minutes, so we need to work a little bit faster. Define the point of view statement in that format. And this is very important. because we are trying to converge into a point, the problem. Next part of this workshop to work, you have to have a problem. So, time to converge into that problem. Another lesson, reiterating my point, always reframe your problem, the problem you have right now, with real human insight. So the other thing about design thinking, even though a lot of us talk it as a process, it is not a process. It's a mindset. So when you write your first point of view statement, and when you go and meet another set of users, or when you build a prototype, and when you learn from that, reframe it. So always refine it until you get. There's no business or a startup or a product that start based on a fixed problem statement or point of view statement. They start with one problem, they learn something new, they change. So if you have a space or in front of your desk, write this point of view statement in the biggest font you can and paste it, because that's going to be your inspiration. At the same time, remember to take it off whenever you learn something new. So, again, same point. Instead of designing a new ATM, now you have a user insight and a need, something new. So now we are going to generate ideas based on that particular point of view statement. This is something we are really good at, right? Even during the last session, I saw that you are really good at coming up with ideas. But again, remember what we are going to do. We are on a divergent mindset now. So don't filter the ideas you get. It might be a crazy idea, it might be a bad idea, it might be something not business, not, there's no business viability, or it's impossible to implement, forget about it. We are just generating ideas. You or your partner or me is not a position to judge them. None of them are going to judge your ideas. Just we are going to write them down. Right? The point is to generate a lot. Hope it's the right slide. Okay. Before that, small warm-up activity. So I'm going to flash few concepts here, words here. You have to draw that particular thing. And you have like 10 seconds for each. It's going to be really fast, just to warm you up. Ready? Pens on the paper. 1, 2, 3. Draw a house. Next one. Draw money. Next one. Draw happiness. 10 seconds, remember. 3, 2, 1. Go on. Next one. Draw innovation. Right, good. So, when it comes to, let's start with happiness. How many of you drew a happy face? Right? Most of you. For innovation, how many of you drew a light bulb? So, see, for something, if you struggle, that's fine, but you drew something. So, during next part of the workshop, the level of detail you put into that drawing is good enough. Right? So when you see that happy face, everyone knows that that's happiness. That's a symbol for happiness. So when you generate ideas, or when you try to design a new product, that level of detail, that level of fidelity is enough for our purpose. Right? So if you are not good at, if you are not really good artist, forget about it. It doesn't matter. We are writing down, or we are putting what's in your head into the paper. For that, that level of detail is good enough, right? So don't try to be an artist, just that rough sketch, 10 minutes, 10 seconds idea on the paper is good enough. Right? Because what we are going to do is, we are going to sketch these ideas just for the purpose of communication. We are not going to show off our artistic skills, we are just going to document. So now we are going to learn a very lightweight technique, because today we are not going to focus on idea generation techniques, but there are enough sources. There are a lot of idea generation techniques where you can try as a group. There are certain brain writing techniques. If you go to IDEO website, or even Design Kit, or D School website, or even just search idea generation techniques for design thinking, there are a lot. Some involves groups, some involves individuals. Today we are going to learn a very lightweight but really fun technique called Crazy 8. For this, you need a blank sheet of paper, at least one side blank. So you have like 8 cells or grids in your paper, right? You have 8. So what we are going to do is, we are going to work really fast, and on each block, when I give you time, you are going to draw the idea you have. When I say time, move to the next block and try to think again. Okay, what else I can do to solve my point of view statement? So if you have your point of statement written, put it in front of you so that you can always look at it. I know it's going to be hard, but remember, we are generating ideas. Don't filter them out. Don't think about whether it's possible or not. Don't feel ashamed that this is a crazy idea. Whatever the idea that comes to your mind, write it down, that you think will solve that point of view statement. Are you clear what to do? And the level of detail of drawing is that happy face. That's good enough. It is a mental nod for yourself when you look at again. So you have approximately 8 minutes to generate 8 ideas. I'll count minutes, and you can generate ideas. So let's start with the first cell. Are you ready? Let's do it. Draw the first idea you have right now on the first cell in very high level, low fidelity. It's a mental note for yourself. Write it down. If you can't draw, even a word is fine. If you start with one idea, which is we are really good at, generating wide idea, then develop it, you might go on the wrong path and come up with a solution which might not be the best solution for that particular problem. So design thinking, it promotes you to diverge and generate a lot of ideas. If you are working in a team of 5, maybe you can have like 50 ideas before you select few. So have a dedicated mindset and a faith. Let's generate a lot of ideas to solve this problem. It's not only applicable for your startup, it can be for any problem. Even if you face a day-to-day problem, that's another learning from design thinking. Instead of going ahead with that one solution, okay, think, okay, that's a good solution. Let's draw it, write it down so that it won't go anywhere. And think again, okay, what else can I do to solve this? What else? It's not a math problem where we only have one solution. Every human problem has multiple solutions. Okay, now what we are going to do is get feedback. Now we are going to show your ideas, sorry I lied, to your partner and ask for their feedback. So this again, another mindset you need to develop. I don't know whether I have a slide on that. No. So when you are, as a design thinker, you should build courage to show your unfinished work. That's another weakness we have, right? Whenever we were given a task, and when someone is expecting us to come up with that output, what happens? We ask for deadline extensions, we ask for more time. Why? We want to show our finished product. But if you wait for the finished product, what happens? It takes time. During that time, you might have put a lot of effort, maybe to the wrong solution. So as a design thinker, learn to show things very fast. Whenever you have idea, tell it someone. It might be an unfinished idea. It can be a very rough. You don't even know how to do it. Maybe I'll make a cash delivery service. Tell it to someone. See whether it works or not. Instead of figuring out, okay, how to ensure the cash is safe, how to ensure we authenticate on the bill. Those are the questions you can find answers to later. Right? So when you are showing your ideas, don't be afraid that they are not finished. Don't be afraid that they are crazy. Your point is to learn. You are going to share your ideas with someone else, especially the user you were inspired by, and see what they think of them. Don't argue, just listen. You can ask questions, but don't argue. We are not trying to build a discussion, or we are not trying to sell your idea. You are not a salesman. So, shall we do that? You have 5 ideas. Partner 1 shows to the partner 2. Show them the point of view statement as well. Get the feedback on that as well. So, the get feedback, the point of view statement, as well as the ideas. Remember, your partner didn't put a lot of effort to that point of view or ideas. So, it's okay to be very critical. That's another common mistake we do. We put a lot of effort into a prototype or idea, and when show it to someone else, even though they hate it, they have to say, I love it, because they know that you have to spend months on that. But when you do quick exercises like this, they also have the liberty to criticize you. So what did you learn? Did you learn anything new by listening to your partner's feedback? Yes. So that's what we are after. We are not after a perfect solution in the first go. What we are after is insights and learning experience. That's all design thinking is about. And the second thing, we prefer action over discussion. We didn't argue. We didn't ask for, we didn't argue about our ideas for a day or two. We just took the idea in a very raw format and present it to the potential user and got their opinion. So this is called bias toward action. In design thinking, ask you to be biased toward action, not towards discussion. So if you have an idea, try it out and learn from it. So now let's reflect on the feedback you got, and we are going to form or select one idea. So there are techniques for that. In this case, we are going to use the feedback and your intuition. That's also fine. Remember, we are not going to pick the idea where your partner, the potential user, said the best idea. Because if you are listening during that feedback session, what you are after is how they react, to learn more about that user and their expectations. Remember Henry Ford, we are not after faster horses. And as Steve Jobs always believed, he never used focus groups. Why? He thought, we are not asking for people's opinion, even though they are end users. Even though it's my customer, I'm not asking for their opinion. I'm going to do what I think right. I'm going to do what I'm passionate about. But I need feedback. I need to learn from mistakes. I need to show my product. But still, I'm going to do what I'm passionate. So after hearing those all feedback, you can still go with the, according to your partner's view, the worst idea. Because you are really passionate and you see the potential. But since you have shared the idea with them, you know the weaknesses of that idea as well. Right? So that's what we are going to do. Take how many minutes? 2-3 minutes and reflect and create a new solution. In this case, we are going to add a little bit more detail to this idea. So earlier we had a very rough idea. During these 3 minutes, think you are a startup and you are going to convert this idea to a product or a service. So now add a little bit of details. Okay, how can I ship this product? This is going to be a cash delivery service. Okay, how we are going to recruit people? How we are going to deliver cash? So we are going to add a little bit of detail. That's another thing we do. We take ideas, we get ideas, we pick them, and we add a little bit of detail. Right? Let's do it. 3 minutes, pick up its idea, redraw it with little bit of detail. So the next activity, since now you have like a little bit of detail with your idea, your preferred idea, what shall we do? Take that idea to production and build a business around it. Now, we are going to test it again. For this time, we are going to, instead of showing the rough sketch, we are going to make the idea a little bit tangible. So in design thinking, you, again, since you are university days, so still if you are in university, you are really good at prototyping, right? If you are a programmer or if you have done any coding, you are really good at prototyping. So there's a major difference from prototyping for that particular purpose and design thinking. In design thinking, we prototype to learn. In normal world, we prototype to see the feasibility of the idea, see the appeal, see the look and feel, and even to sell. But our purpose is to learn from it. So typically when we do this, today we are not going to do, or we will try. We don't give equipments. We don't give you anything other than the piece of paper and a pen and yourself, and ask you to make your idea tangible within 7 minutes. Now think about the idea you selected. And if you got 7 minutes, some piece of papers and pen and whatever in your pocket, if you are to convert it into a prototype, how would you do it? You know the reason behind that. Instead of going into this activity, let's do it. Do you know the reason behind that? Why I and the design thinking trainers or workshop conductors do that? Because they like to make your life miserable? No. The reason is, like I said earlier, when you show a prototype to someone to learn from it, if you put a lot of effort, the typical response you get is, all right, it's a nice product, or it's nice, because they feel a little bit discouraged to criticize, unless that person has a really good habit of criticizing finished products. But if they know that you only put 7 minutes and you assembled it using the things you in your pocket and what's around you, and if you can give it to that person as a use, for example, if it is a, let's say a mobile app, you draw a few screens and ask, put the first screen, ask them to click it. If you click this, I'll give you this second, using a piece of paper. If you do that, they know that you haven't put a lot of effort and they feel no fear of criticizing you. Since our objective is to learn, put minimum effort on your prototypes so that it can only communicate and it can use to only use for your learning experience, right? Without making your life painful, I'll try to finish our session. So, lesson from the last part. Be very brave to show your unfinished work. That's a habit you need to develop if you get into this business. Never wait until your finished product is finished. And don't be fear that someone is going to steal your idea. That's a different story. Because sooner you tell it to someone, sooner you make it tangible and use it in a real life scenario or simulated environment, you will learn from it. And that will help you to transform or pivot into something even more remarkable. Okay, if you have done that, what would you use? You will give it to your partner to use it. You will silently look at it and see, okay, what are the observations? Then we would have repeated the exercise. And before even leaving this room, after like 1 hour and 45 minutes, you will learn whether that idea will work or not based on the observation, whether it's worthwhile of putting another night or two nights into that idea. So design thinking is not a process. At the same time, it's not about innovations. It's about building your mindset so that the innovator inside you comes out. And the best way to master, so this design thinking, it's a mindset and it takes little bit of time to master. But the good thing is you can start. You can start practicing with your experience, and over the time you learn things. I've been like doing it like for 2-3 years. No, 3-4 years. I still learn new things. And the only and the best way to is apply it. Apply to every problem you get. Especially if it's a human problem, try different techniques. Instead of zooming into solution, try diverging. Instead of discussing or arguing about idea, tell your friends, okay, let's stop, let's put it into action and see whether this works or not. Let's try to make a very low budgetary prototype and see whether this works or not. If it works, good. If it doesn't, right, let's move on. So, key takeaways from today. Let's develop during up to December. Let's try to develop a design thinking mindset. If you are not convinced about the tools, go and read, search design thinking case studies, starting from big Silicon Valley giants to, there are many startups who practice. In IBM, 70% people are certified design thinkers. I don't know how to certify a person, but they have done it. So every big organization, even in Sri Lanka, going after design thinking. Why? They see the value of this way of solving problems. They have seen the results. So developing mindset is very simple. First thing, first commitment you have to make to yourself. Learn to be brave to show your unfinished work. The second one we didn't cover in detail today. Be brave to participate in things you are not good at. Because we are not afraid of being judged. We are here to do something remarkable. Choose to act when you are in an endless discussion. Discussions will never make you move forward. If you are in argument, think what you argue about and try to convert it into action and see whether it works or not in a controlled environment. There's no harm of doing that. And lastly and most importantly, be fearless of failing at things. So you need to learn to fail at things. When you fail, you will learn. And if you are afraid of failing, you will never learn. So, like I said earlier, the best way to master design thinking is through real projects. So I recommend you to try real projects. If you want real projects, there are a really good source. There's an organization called OpenITO. They publish real human challenges time to time with huge cash and other prizes. Some have like $1 million attached to it. Some have like very exclusive visits to Silicon Valley and some money and the trip cost and funding for your idea. So this is a platform you can practice. It's OpenITO. IEEE. To finish, again, remember this, design thinking is not a process. So never try to apply it in steps. I'll do empathy part, inspiration part, then I'll move to idea generation, then I'll prototype, then I'll learn. That's not how it works. You get ideas, you test them, you learn again, you go to build more empathy towards users, you reframe your problem, then you learn again. So it's an ongoing thing. So do whatever you are normally doing with these mindsets. You are here because you have done something remarkable, right? Don't get rid of that. But learn to apply these mindsets to your normal working process. For example, I'm a business analyst in profession. So when I saw this set of awesome toolkits, I didn't jump by forgetting what I have been doing. What I did was, I start applying the concepts, the mindsets from the design thinking to what I do. So this is something applicable, whether you are a software engineer, whether you are a business analyst, whether you are a student, whether you are a completely different domain, you are a farmer, engineer. It's enriching. So because in every profession, in every discipline, there are human connected problems. For that, we can use design thinking to give you a new perspective. It's not the solution. It will open up you to a new dimension. Thank you.